Last weekend was pretty huge for the Star Wars Squadrons competitive scene, where we saw the first event in the Calrissian Cup, a 10-month series of Squadrons esports tournaments. We saw 60-something teams whittled down to just one, with Galactic Ace Squadron taking the victory of this Winter Miner. And many of the best matches were broadcast live on Twitch. Not only was this some of the most intense Squadrons gameplay I've ever seen, there was actually quite a lot that I learned from watching some of the best pilots of the galaxy strut their stuff. What's up, you guys? I'm not amazing, I'm just mediocre, and I'm here today to share with you the best tips and tricks that I picked up on from watching professional Squadrons players compete in the Calrissian Cup. Now, we're going to be covering a wide range of subjects, from general team strategy to the roles of individual starfighters to the shifting meta around which components are most powerful in this current version of Star Wars Squadrons. Now, we're going to get into it right away with something that seems obvious, but you don't actually see a ton of down in the lower ranks of Squadrons. And if you want to get into the higher ranks, like Valiant and Legend and Galactic Ace especially, then it's something you're going to have to start doing. And that's becoming a more specialized pilot, picking a specific role and getting very good at it. Very few, if any, of the pros I saw were what you'd consider a flex player, someone who's going to change their roles midway between match to fill any perceived shortcomings on the team. Instead, everyone had actually pre-planned roles that they rarely, if ever, deviated from, and there were just three pretty consistent roles you could find being filled on every single team: interceptors, objective players, and maybe a support player as well. And kind of going hand in hand with every player having a specific specialty was one very common team composition that seemed well balanced and exceedingly powerful. And that was two objective players, two interceptors, and one support player. And we're going to talk about what each of those players was doing most often on the winning teams. Starting with support, if there was a player running a support on a squad, it was almost undoubtedly running Squadron Mask and Targeting Beacon, extremely powerful components in the current meta. Squadron Mask allows you to hide all four of your teammates, and if you're all working together and all huddled around that support player when you go to make your attack run, can be extremely powerful. Then add that with the targeting beacons, which give the enemies a debuff. It's going to make them take 30% more damage. Enemy fighters will not be able to use their components. And if you didn't know this, you can actually use those targeting beacons on enemy capital ships as well, like the corvettes, raiders, cruisers, frigates, and the flagships. All those bad boys can take the extra damage that the targeting beacons can offer. So if you're a support player, make sure you're running Squadron Mask and Targeting Beacons. Now, the objective players were the only ones that would actually switch between two different ships depending on what phase you were on, both in the opening dogfighter phase in order to get morale, as well as in the defense phase. They would run bombers with the Goliath missile and multi-lock missiles in order to farm AI. Now, you can hate on this tactic all you want, but the fact remains that devs put packs of AI fighters into this game for a reason. When you're going up against skilled pilots, sometimes they can be difficult to shoot down. And in higher levels of Squadrons gameplay, it can be a requirement to have at least one fighter on farming AI. And the Galactic Agriculture Squadron, which took home the victory for this, generally had two players on farming AI whenever they were on defense. Those same two players would then flip into X-Wings when they got onto offense, and instead of carrying torpedoes, would use a different ordnance. You see, there is currently a strategy in the higher levels of Star Wars Squadrons where someone will camp right on top of the objective, and when torpedoes get close, they will use a chaff in order to stop that torpedo from landing, preventing any damage from happening and forcing you to waste a very valuable piece of munitions when you only have a small handful of torpedoes at any given time. So to counter this chaffing strategy, we saw many pro players pick concussion missiles instead. These missiles, while they do a lot less damage than proton torpedoes, have a much higher ammo capacity, so it doesn't hurt your potential damage pool quite as much if you have one of those auxiliaries intercepted. They also recharge at a much faster rate, can lock on at a close range, and even be dumbfired at a close range as well. So the primary strategy of objective players when they were on offense is to do drift dances around their objectives while laying in constant barrages of burst fire laser cannons, as well as dropping their concussion missiles whenever they were available. Then of course you have the interceptors, fast and nimble, really good at hunting down enemy starfighters, but that's not necessarily your primary goal. Yes, if you can get some kills, that's great, but you're really meant to be covering your other players, your objective players, and your support players. If they have enemies that are coming up on their tail, it's the interceptor's job to get them off that tail. But you also want to prevent that from happening in the first place by making yourself a big, loud distraction. Being very fast, very nimble, using that speed to your advantage, and trying to force enemies to chase you, because every second an enemy is chasing you is a second that they're not chasing your objective players. And this is, of course, an objective-based game. The kills can help, but they don't necessarily lead to a victory. It's not always the team with the highest kills that ends up destroying the flagship. So the interceptor's main job is to be a big fat nuisance and distract the enemy team from doing their job. And if you get some kills along the way, more power to you. Now to go along with all this awesome team composition, you're going to need some great team communication. If you've listened to any of these teams while they're playing a competitive game of Squadrons, it's literally non-stop callouts. I'm targeting this person, they've got low health. There's somebody on my back, I need coverage. D is about to go down, we should shoot D. I'm returning the base to get some supplies. Like, they are saying every single thing that's going on, keeping the situational awareness for the entire team at maximum. So as a general rule of thumb, more communication is better than less. If you have a headset, if you have a microphone, plug it in, start talking to your teammates. And that'll probably also help you start making some friends so you can form this squadron where everybody has dedicated roles like I'm talking about. Now moving on from team strategy and starfighter roles, one of the big surprises out of the Calrissian Cup was a strong meta to counter defenders. And that was A-wings with ion lasers. These were exceptionally effective against defenders, because while those have extremely strong shields, they have ridiculously weak hulls, and in fact can be shredded with raw ion lasers alone. No extra auxiliaries required. So defenders, you guys gotta be on the lookout for those A-wings now, especially if they're carrying ion lasers. And that was definitely something I noticed in general, that most, if not all, of the players on a particular team had some kind of ion damage equipped, whether that be in the form of those ion lasers on the A-wings, maybe they were carrying ion missiles instead. We also saw lots of torpedoes and rockets as well. So everybody had some kind of ion damage, and this was very helpful for breaking through not only that strong defender meta, but also getting through into the capital ships as well. If everybody on the team has ion damage equipped, that means you can all very quickly destroy the shields on an enemy flagship, and that means all of you can very quickly start assaulting some of those subsystems. And in particular, Galactic Agriculture Squadron made quick work of the Randalorians in this final match with a one phase three subsystem destruction, where they took out all of their shield generators and their power systems in one go, and then they took them out finish the game on the very next phase. So having that ability to quickly rip off the shields by coordinating your entire team carrying some kind of ion damage is going to be extremely powerful for making a strong attack phase on the enemy flagship. Super important for securing a victory. It was awesome to watch this entire competition go down, and pleasantly surprising to see the formation of these ion laser and concussion missile strategies. But it came as no shock to see that every single one of these pro players was abusing the dead drifting mechanic. Now, if you don't know what dead drifting is and you want to know how to do it, go ahead and click the video you see on your screen right now. It'll explain to you exactly how to take advantage of dead drifting and what it will do to take your Star Wars Squadrons gameplay to the next level. I hope to see you guys in that video. In the meantime, I'm not amazing, I'm just meaty yogurt, and I'm out.